We've been studying continually from the book of Acts, and we're on chapter 15 of Acts. But before we go into that, you all know the portion from Amos chapter 3, verse 3. Can two walk together except they be agreed? Can two walk together except they be agreed? As long as there's two different human beings with two different wills, two different emotions, there is bound to be some sort of conflict. And we're really good at that. Resolving conflict or working on reconciliation after there's a conflict is not such an easy task. And we're usually slow and backwards in resolving conflict. It's almost as if we think that if we ignore it long enough, it may disappear. And at least I should say, I'm not a confrontational person, so I like to ignore things myself. But in today, Acts chapter 15, we see a role model of a conflict resolution and reconciliation that happened in the first century church. As you're turning to Acts chapter 15, the portion that I read in Amos chapter 3, verse 3 is, can two walk together except they be agreed? Conflicts, arguments, and disagreements, as I said, is a natural part of our lives as a human being. In every community group, even among the church community, there could be disagreements because the church is made up of human beings with different thought processes, brought up in different homes, different communities, and so there could be some reason for disagreements. And actually, in Acts chapter 15, there's two such conflicts talked about. The first was a doctrinal conflict, and the second was a difference of opinion. And we'll study both of those. The second one, the difference of opinion, we have studied deeply in the past, and so I will just mention it. And we see how the church in Jerusalem was able to reconcile and give proper direction to the church in Antioch. And we see how this problem was resolved. So make sure you're turning to Acts chapter 15 with me and following along. So the first conflict that we see here, Joe touched on it last week. But before we get to that, let me just remind you that chapter 14 ends with the missionary journey of Paul and Barnabas. It was their first missionary journey, and they had gone from Antioch. The Holy Spirit had ordained them, and they went out to many of the places that are mentioned, and they went to spread the gospel, and wherever they went, we see that churches were formed, and we see that there were disciples made, and these disciples, some of them were Jewish converts, but not all of them were Jewish. Some of them were Gentiles, and Gentiles had a different way of worship. They would worship with all kinds of pagan rituals, and they would have all kinds of different things before they came to the saving knowledge of Christ. And after coming to the saving knowledge of Christ and having the Holy Spirit deal with them, they become wholehearted followers of Jesus and obey the word of God and by grace. So grace alone, by faith alone, in Christ alone, they are saved and into the salvation experience. And they are truly fellow brothers and sisters with the Jewish Christians as well. But we see in the beginning of chapter 15, we see that Paul and Barnabas started to debate some people that came. So these were called the Judaizers, or these were the Pharisees, or the Jewish people that came from the Jerusalem church. They were not sent. They just came to the Antioch church and said some false doctrine. They said that in order to be saved, you have to follow all of Moses' laws, and you have to be circumcised physically. And so Paul and Barnabas got up and got into a sharp debate with them, it says. And then because this debate could not be controlled, they decided to go down to Jerusalem. Paul and Barnabas, along with some others, went down to Jerusalem, and they started to seek the advice of the initial church in Jerusalem, the apostles that were with Jesus, and the leaders of that church. And we see something known as the Jerusalem Council that happens in that place. The Jerusalem Council was a group meeting of the leaders of the Jerusalem church. And we see that first, the Judaizers start to give their argument. And so the Judaizers say their argument, which is that it is necessary to circumcise them in order to keep the law of Moses. So the Pharisees stood up and said that it is necessary to circumcise a physical circumcision in order to make them Christians. And that, we know, is not the true gospel. We see Peter, the apostles and the elders were gathered together, and Simeon, it says, which is referring to Simon Peter, gets up and says that 10 years ago, I used to think like you guys as well, but the Holy Spirit came to me and said to go to this house of a Gentile man named Cornelius, and he was a centurion, and I did not want to go, but I obeyed the Holy Spirit, and I saw with my own eyes how the Holy Spirit moved among that household and how they got a true salvation experience. And so Peter is giving his testimony of the past and the past experiences that he had, and saying, this is how it is, and this is what I've seen, and what I have learned from the Lord, they are truly wholeheartedly Christians. Next, we see Paul and Barnabas get up. We see Paul and Barnabas get up and say the very similar thing. They said, everywhere we traveled in our first missionary journey in the island and also in the northern parts of Turkey and Galatia, that we saw people that were genuinely saved by grace alone, by faith alone, in Christ alone. And he said that there is no works that needs to be added to that. There is no need to add a physical circumcision or any other works that is needed to be added to that. In fact, we see that Paul writes the book of Galatians in AD 46 and 47, I believe, right as this Jerusalem Council happens in 49 AD. So right at this time, there is this brewing of a controversy and dissension that in order for the Gentiles to be saved, they must go through circumcision. And we see Peter gets up in this council and defends the Gentiles and says no. And then we see Paul and Barnabas get up and say no. And then the leader of the church, many of us think that Peter was the pastor of the Jerusalem church, but indeed, according to what is said there, it might very well have been James, the half-brother of Jesus, who had the final decision. And he was pastoring that church. And in his wisdom, he got up and he said something. And that is starting with verse 14 onwards. And so it says, Simeon has related how Christ, or how God first visited the Gentiles to take them as a people for his name. And with his words of the prophets agree, and the words of the prophets agree. That's what I want to focus on here. The words of the prophet. So Simeon had given his personal testimony about what happened. We see that Paul and Barnabas gives his personal testimony, but the pastor there, which is James or Jacob in Malayalam, gets up, the half-brother of Jesus, and he is a very learned man in the Jewish laws and traditions. And you would think that if he was being partial, he would say, yes, they need to be circumcised. But instead, he ponders in his mind about what is written in the prophecies. He remembers what Amos chapter 9 says, 9:11 onwards. It talks about how there needs to be, the house of David needs to be restored, and they had gone away, and there needs to be a restoration of the people that have gone away, and that will come through the line of David in the name of Jesus, and the people that are the Gentiles can be saved. We see the same things mentioned in a couple of other prophetical verses as well, in Zechariah chapter 2, verse 11, where it says, many nations shall join themselves to the Lord in that day and shall be my people, and I will dwell in the midst of you. So the answer to your question is that the prophecy James is citing saying the prophets speak. And then again, we see that in Isaiah 11, verse 10, in that day, the root of Jesse shall stand to ensign his peoples, and shall be many nations who seek, and his dwelling shall be glorious. So looking back at the prophetical words of Isaiah, Zechariah, and Amos, he gives a compelling argument that the people that are considered different than us, the people that have no rights as the Jewish people did, because of the blood of Jesus, these people have equal footing now, and they have the right to be called the children of God. As we read in Romans chapter 11, we were the wild olive that was grafted together with Christ. We who are separated have the right now to be coming to the throne of grace, and we have the right to be called children of God. So we see that James, using his knowledge, his Jewish knowledge, his prophetical teaching, is coming to a conclusion. And after this conclusion, we see that they all agree. We see that they all start to agree. And then we see that they decide to write it up, and they send it with two people. They send it with Judas and Silas. Judas, known as Barsabbas, and also Silas. And they send it back to Antioch. So this portion, even though we didn't read through it, I'm sure you guys are familiar with this, and I just went through it systematically. But there are some things that we can learn from this and apply in our life. So if you would go to that slide for me. The first thing that happens here, I've already talked about Paul and Barnabas and the first missionary journey and how this problem came about. Next slide, please. See, we see a doctrinal dispute here. We see the dispute in chapter 15, verse 1 through 6. We see the defense, the past defense from Peter, the present defense from Paul and Barnabas, and the future prophetical defense from James. And there is a decision that is made, and everyone decides to agree upon this decision. The second dispute was much less doctrinal. It was just a difference of opinion. It was a difference of opinion between, after all of this is resolved, and we'll get back to the first dispute, but I know I've spoken about the second dispute before. It is a dispute between two saints, Paul and Barnabas. It's just a difference of opinion on who they should take on their second missionary journey. They decide, Paul says, I don't want to take a deserter, the person who left us in Pamphylia on our first missionary journey, and he is adamant about it, and they get into a heated argument, and we see that Barnabas, who is known as the son of encouragement, decides to take John Mark, and we're thankful that he did, because he was able to write the book of Mark and learn so much through his journeys and hanging out with the disciples. But Paul decides to take Silas. Silas, the same man who came with him after the Jerusalem Council decision, came and stayed with him in Antioch and was teaching in a great way in Antioch, is the one that decides to go with Paul. And there, we see that there are two great gospel teams that are formed over this disagreement. And we see Paul and Silas going in one direction, and Silas becomes, after this journey, a pastor in Corinth, and he becomes the leader in the Corinthian church and dies in Corinth, is what history says. And we see Barnabas and Mark. And Mark, we know, writes the book of Mark. So this was just a difference of opinion. And it was something that was a terse discussion, but it did not lead to major problems. Because later, we see Paul asks for Mark, and we see that they have a working relationship. But coming back to the first one, which is a doctrinal disagreement, we cannot have any compromise in the doctrinal disagreement. And we see that what is the way of salvation is what is being debated. Salvation is by grace alone, by faith alone, in Christ Jesus alone. Because he has done the work on the cross of Calvary, Anyone who believes by faith on the name of the Lord Jesus and confesses him as a Savior and is willing to accept this free grace has the right, and that is what we as Christians believe. But adding on anything extra, as the Judaizers were trying to do, was not something that the first century Christians would not agree to. Imagine if they had agreed to that. We as Malayali Pentecostals would, when we come to the Lord, would have to go through physical circumcision. Instead of amazing grace, how sweet the sound, we might have been singing amazing circumcision, how sweet the sound. Or by the blood of Jesus, we should be singing something else. So thank God that the first century leaders had the wherewithal and the decision to stand firm on doctrinal things. And on doctrinal things, there is no room for any bit of compromise. We see the decision is made, the decree is sent out with Silas and Judas, and there is a rededication where Silas stays on in Antioch and teaches and then goes on to the missionary journey, the second missionary journey, as a partner for Paul. So what can we learn from this? I had written out about 7 or 8 points here. This is a model for reconciliation within the church. As I said, disputes and problems within the church is not anything new. It was there among the saints in the first century church. As long as there's different humans with different character, different personalities, there will be some sort of disagreement. But in this important matter of doctrinal disagreement, they came together to consider the matters. They allowed individuals to speak uninterrupted. Others stayed quiet and listened with respect. They used the word of God as a foundation for all their decisions. And we see how James used the prophetical word and realized that the prophecy was talking about the Lord Jesus in Amos and also in Isaiah and in Jeremiah, and how the Gentiles were to be part, and this was the plan of God, and it came through the Lord Jesus. So they used the word, as we'll hear later, as a foundation for all of their decision. They had a leader for the group that came to a conclusion, and they formed a uniform position and spoke with one mind and one mouth. And the leader, what the leader said after this decision was made was what was the decision. And having witnesses from all parties involved was important. And all of them accepted the decision once it was made. And we see that the church continued to thrive. Thank God that there was this decision made in this doctrinal issue. And so hopefully, as you're going through chapter 15, you see two different conflicts. And one is a doctrinal one, and another one is a difference of opinion. And the Jerusalem Council, the first century leaders, had the wisdom to make the right decision in this conflict. And let this be an example for us as we face conflict, as we have differences of opinion. Instead of fighting against each other, instead of backbiting or gossiping, let us use this model as our resolution path, and let us come to an agreement that is godly, that is on the Word of God, that is on the foundation of the Word of God, led by the Holy Spirit. So I just want to conclude by saying some of the things that I learned from this is salvation is by grace alone, by faith alone, in Christ alone, and believing on the finished work of the Lord on the cross. No additions of human works. Yes, the Holy Spirit might speak for a certain time about certain things, but if we decide to make that our theology, instead of believing in the Word of God and what the Word of God says is the path of salvation, if we add on other things, like the Jews were trying to add on circumcision, if we add on other things that are our human works, then it will be as if Christ died in vain. We see in Galatians, Galatians was written when Paul was really mad about this, right before this Jerusalem decision. So if you have time, go back and read Galatians. And I can go through from each chapter how Paul is saying, if you're adding on your own works, if you're adding on your own things to the finished work on the cross by the Lord Jesus, instead of
trusting in grace alone, by faith alone, in Christ alone, if you're adding on human effort, human striving to earn your salvation, then you are mistaken. But that does not mean that after you're saved, that you continue to be sanctified daily, that you continue to work out your salvation. And as you work out your salvation in love for your master, you will have good works automatically produced out of you. Not out of an obligation of doing good works, but good works will automatically come out of you. Another thing I learned, in the essential thing, like the doctrinal things, there needs to be unity, and there cannot be one iota to the left or right on the doctrinal things. But in the non-essential things, there is some liberty that should be taken. There is freedom in Christ and liberty in the non-essential things. But above all, if we put charity, if we put the love of Christ, then there is chances that we can resolve any conflict that we have with the love of Christ. The same grace that he has given to us, if we show it to others, we can resolve any conflict that might arise with the love of Christ. Conflict is not to be avoided or ignored, but it is an opportunity to show others the grace of the Lord Jesus, as we read in 2 Timothy. You know, God and man had a conflict. God created man in his own image without sin, but the first Adam committed sin in the Garden of Eden and was separated from God. And so God and man had a conflict, and there needed to be a resolution. And God did not ignore it. God sent his only son to die upon the cross for us. The one who knew no sin became sin for us. He took upon the wrath of God in his body, and he became the salvation for us. There is no need to add on to that, but trusting in the Lord Jesus by grace that he has offered. It is not of our merit, by grace alone. It is by faith in Jesus alone that we are able to be saved. And let us learn from this as we continue to resolve any conflict that will naturally come up. May God bless you all with these words.